For the next few minutes, we're going to talk about the 1955 Fairlane in plain, factual terms. We're going to show you how this car is a better buy than the Pontiac Chieftain 860 series, the Olds 88, the Buick Special, and the Dodge Coronet, four major competitors in the medium price field. What the average man fails to realize about these four automobiles is that they are the price leaders of their respective makes, with a very minimum of performance, of comfort, convenience, and luxury items. He fails to realize that for less money than he would pay for these price leaders, he could have top luxury and top performance in the top car of the Ford line. Nevertheless, many people do buy the Pontiac Chieftain 860. But it's fairly obvious that they saddle themselves with this stripped car because no Ford salesmen have shown them that in a Fairlane they can actually get more of the things they really want for less. Now, you may be asking yourself, is this true? Does the Fairlane offer more than the Pontiac Chieftain 860? Let's compare. First of all, how about initial cost? The Pontiac Chieftain 860 four-door costs about $70 more than the Fairlane town sedan with special V8. Why? Better performance? Guess again. Compare the Fairlane special V8 with the Pontiac V8. Fairlane's displacement of 272 cubic inches is less than Pontiac's 287.2, but the Fairlane's compression ratio of 8.5 to 1 is higher. Fairlane's more efficient engine generates 182 horsepower from its displacement. Pontiac's provides 180. We also beat them in the important measurement of torque. Fairlane, 268 pounds-feet. Pontiac, 264 pounds-feet. To put it simply, Fairlane's engine is a livelier, more economical performer, with 55.7 horsepower per 1,000 pounds of car weight to Pontiac's 51.3 horsepower. But that's not the whole story of engine superiority. In addition, the Fairlane Special V8 provides the advantages of anti-fouling 18-millimeter spark plugs, precision-molded alloy iron crankshaft, free-turning valves, four-barrel carburetor, and dual exhaust, whereas Pontiac uses 14-millimeter old-style spark plugs, forged steel crankshaft, non-rotating valves, two-barrel carburetor, and single exhaust. Transmissions, too, have a great deal to do with performance. Both Fordomatic and Pontiac's Hydromatic have planetary gears. However, Fordomatic has three forward-speed gears combined with a torque converter, whereas Hydromatic must use four forward-speed gears, for it is combined with the less efficient fluid coupling. Thus, Fordomatic has a greater engine torque multiplication in the transmission for smoother and faster acceleration. In addition, Fordomatic gives the driver an accelerator-controlled choice of low or intermediate gear starts, whereas Pontiac's Hydromatic is less flexible, for it always starts in low gear unless manually shifted. Furthermore, Fordomatic allows a downshift up to 65 miles an hour to a more powerful passing gear. Pontiac's Hydromatic has a downshift only up to 60 miles an hour. Perhaps the best proof of Fordomatic's superiority is the fact that in 1955, Lincoln has discarded Hydromatic in favor of the more efficient Fordomatic type of transmission. Now, let's look at one other performance factor, the ability to stop fast. Ford has 192 square inches of brake lining. Pontiac, only 178. For every 1,000 pounds of car weight, the Fairlane has 58.8 square inches of brake lining. Pontiac has 50.7. Which car should have greater stopping ability? It's pretty obvious. And look at the front suspensions of the two cars. Ford uses the modern ball joint. Pontiac is still stuck with the old-style kingpin, which requires constant attention and wheel alignments and makes steering harder. But until you get into the two cars, you can't really appreciate the fact that the Fairlane, benefiting from the advantages of volume production of the entire Ford car line, offers far more luxury for less cost than Pontiac. Take upholstery, for example. The Fairlane Town Sedan buyer gets a choice of three luxurious, color-harmonized interior fabrics. The Pontiac 860 four-door buyer gets no choice at all. It doesn't make any difference what color car he buys. The upholstery remains the same. To get a choice of upholstery, he has to pay still another $100 and select a model from the Pontiac 870 series. Luxurious foam rubber is standard on Fairlane seats front and rear. Pontiac uses cheap cotton padding. A deep pile carpet adds luxury and color to both front and rear floors of the Fairlane. Pontiac buyers get rubber covering, both front and rear. The Fairlane's gracefully designed instrument panel includes a convenient clock as standard equipment. Pontiac's instrument panel has provision for a clock, if you want to pay the extra money for it. Adding it all up, the interior of the Pontiac Chieftain 860 is no match in luxury and smartness for the interior of the brilliant Fairlane. Well then, what does the higher-priced Pontiac have to offer over the Fairlane? Far greater roominess? Compare. Front headroom. Fairlane, 35.1 inches. Pontiac, 35.6. Rear headroom, 34.2, 35.9. Steering wheel clearance, 5.4 inches, 5.1. Front seat height, 12.6 to 13.7. Rear seat height, Fairlane, 13.1 inches. Pontiac, 12 inches. Who's got the edge? Front leg room. Fairlane, 44.3 inches, Pontiac, 42.7. Rear leg room, 41.9 to 42.8. Front shoulder room, 57 inches to 56.6. Rear shoulder room, 56.8 to 56.4 inches. When you realize that the maximum difference in these dimensions is this much, sometimes in the Fairlane's favor, sometimes in Pontiac's, you can readily see that the Fairlane and the Pontiac are completely competitive in interior roominess, where it counts. So where does this so-called bigger car get its bigness? Certainly not in width. The Fairlane is 75.9 inches wide, and Pontiac is 75.4. Where, then, is this bigness? Right here, in 4.7 inches of greater outside length. 4.7 inches of bulky, heavy, harder to move, harder to stop, harder to park, unneeded sheet metal. This is what Pontiac has to offer against the Fairlane's more powerful V8, more flexible Fordomatic, modern ball-joint suspension, equal roominess, more luxurious interiors, and more distinctive styling. Can you sell all of these extra values, the values people really want, against 4 7/10 inches of excess length? You certainly can, especially when you back up your sales efforts with this simple but powerful statement. Why pay more and get less? Fairlane versus Olds 88. The Oldsmobile has most of the features, or lack of features, of the Pontiac. Except it costs even more, with a suggested list price about $265 more than the Fairlane with special V8. Is it worth it? Let's see how the Olds 88 stacks up against the Fairlane for interior roominess. Front headroom, Fairlane, 35.1 inches, Olds, 35.6. Rear headroom, 34.2 to 34.6. Steering wheel clearance, 5.4 to 4.9. Front seat height, 12.6 to 13.2. Rear seat height, 13.1 to 12.4. Front leg room. Fairlane, 44.3 inches. Olds, 42.9 inches. Rear leg room, 41.9 to 43.8. Front shoulder room, 57 to 58.2. Rear shoulder room, 56.8 inches to 56.7. Six of one and half a dozen of the other. The thickness of a package of cigarettes in most instances, either in Fairlane's favor or Oldsmobile's, making both cars fully competitive in interior roominess, but not in luxury. Here the Fairlane far outshines the Olds 88. Compare the comfortable foam rubber of the Fairlane seats to the cheap cotton padding used by Olds. Compare the Fairlane's deep pile carpet to Old's rubber floor mats. Compare the little touches, like a clock as standard equipment on the Fairlane, to Oldsmobile's lack of this convenience item. The Fairlane offers a choice of six models, including three hardtops. Old's 88 offers only three models in all. In the complete lineup of Fairlane models, the buyer has a choice of 15 stunning interior combinations. Old's 88 offers only three. Now, let's look at engines. The Fairlane Special V8 has a 272 cubic inch displacement compared to Old's 324. But with the same compression ratio of 8.5 to 1, Fairlane's V8 develops 182 horsepower compared to Old's 185. Ford's torque rating of 268 pounds-feet is lower than Old's 320. But in power per pound, or effective power, the Fairlane is out front. The Fairlane develops 55.7 horsepower per 1,000 pounds of car weight to Old's 49.9 horsepower. In other words, Fairlane has more power to move its weight than Oldsmobile. And compare other engine features. The Fairlane Special V8 offers anti-fouling 18mm spark plugs, precision-molded alloy iron crankshaft, free-turning valves, four-barrel carburetor, and dual exhaust. The Olds 88 has none of these features. Features that contribute to smoothness, durability, and dependable economical performance. In addition, its old-style kingpins are no match for the Fairlane's modern ball joints. And its hydromatic transmission lacks the smoothness and flexibility of Fordomatic. Brake lining areas are almost equal. 192 square inches for Fairlane to 191.7 for Olds. But compared to weight, it's a different story. For every 1,000 pounds of car weight, the Fairlane has 58.8 square inches of brake lining available for stopping. Olds has only 51.7. Again, like Pontiac, Oldsmobile lugs around 4.9 inches of bulky, heavy, hard-to-park excess length to make it a so-called bigger car. So there's a quick point-by-point check you can use in selling against Olds 88. They have greater length and torque. The Fairlane has a big advantage in luxury, convenience, choice of models, suspension, and brake lining and power-to-weight ratios. And above all, you have a great advantage in price. Remember this. A Fairlane town sedan with special V8, Fordomatic, plus a radio, plus heater, plus power steering and power brakes, white wall tires, windshield washer and turn indicator costs less than an Olds 88 equipped with only automatic transmission and radio. Remind the would-be Olds 88 buyer of this powerful sales point. Why pay more and get less? Fairlane versus Buick Special. About $220 more. That's how much more a buyer would have to pay for a Buick Special with Dynaflow than for a Fairlane town sedan with Fordomatic and Y-Block Special V8, based on suggested list prices. Let's see if the Buick Special gives the customer any more car for that extra $220. They certainly should. How does the Fairlane Special V8 stack up against the Buick Special V8? Fairlane's displacement is greater, 272 cubic inches to 264. Compression ratio is higher, 8.5 to 1 compared to 8.4 to 1. 182 horsepower for the Fairlane to an advertised 188 for Buick. But in torque, the Fairlane puts out 268 pounds-feet to Buick's 256. Furthermore, the horsepower story figures like this. Fairlane has 55.7 horsepower per 1,000 pounds of car weight. Buick has only 50.2. Furthermore, Buick uses small 14mm spark plugs, a forged steel crankshaft, non-rotating valves, a two-barrel carburetor, and single exhaust. That's far from competitive with anti-fouling 18mm spark plugs, the precision-molded alloy iron crankshaft, free-turning valves, four-barrel carburetor, and dual exhaust in the Fairlane, isn't it? Buick this year claims an improvement in its automatic transmission, Dynaflow. When the accelerator is floorboarded, the blades in the torque converter are now supposed to change position and provide faster acceleration with less of the slippage and wasted engine revolutions that Dynaflow is famous for. However, the driver still cannot use Dynaflow for engine braking at higher speeds, since a manual downshift is not recommended above 40 miles per hour. Ford-O-Matic can be manually downshifted at any speed for safer, surer engine braking whenever desired, such as on steep downgrades. It's certainly apparent that neither Buick's engine nor its transmission has any extra value features that would account for that extra $220 they want for the car. And when you compare the Fairlane's 192 square inches of brake lining to Buick's 184.6, you actually begin to wonder how they get away with it. That's 58.8 square inches of brake lining for every 1,000 pounds of Fairlane's weight, to 49.3 square inches for every 1,000 pounds of the Buick Special. And look at Ford's front suspension with modern ball joints and Buick's old-style kingpins. Look at the Fairlane's modern Hotchkiss drive and Buick's old-style rigid torque tube drive. Why, even Chevrolet has abandoned that kind of drive in favor of the smoother-running Hotchkiss. But step inside the Buick and examine the wonderful luxury offered to the buyer of a Special. Cotton padding on the seats and rubber on the floor, both front and rear. Isn't that fine? And you get a wide, wide choice of one standard upholstery fabric in the Buick Special. Take it or leave it. On second thought, you can leave it. For Buick does offer the buyer a custom trim option that includes a little fancier and more colorful upholstery for approximately $50 extra. That's in addition to the higher basic cost of $220 more than the Fairlane, which has foam rubber seats and deep pile carpet, both front and rear, and a wide choice of luxurious interior trims at no extra cost. Buick's bulky instrument panel doesn't include a clock as standard equipment either, whereas the Fairlane's does. But maybe Buick charges $220 more for a roomier interior. Let's see. Front leg room, 44.3 inches for the Fairlane, 42.3 for Buick. Rear leg room, 41.9 to 41.8. Front shoulder room, 57 to 58.2. Rear shoulder room, 56.8 to 56.7. Front headroom, Fairlane 35.1 inches, Buick 35.6 inches. Rear headroom 34.2 to 34. Steering wheel clearance 5.4 to 5.2. Front seat height 12.6 to 12.6. Rear seat height 13.1 to 12.4. The Fairlane has a slight advantage in almost every case. Well then, what does the Buick Special offer over the Fairlane? I suppose we'll have to go back to the same old thing. The Buick has 8.2 inches more length, 8 2/10 inches of heavy, bulky, hard-to-park excess sheet metal. Is this 8.2 inches of extra length worth $220? Do the would-be Buick buyers you talk to know that a Fairlane with Ford-O-Matic, the Special V8, radio, heater, power brakes, windshield washer, turn indicator, white wall tires, wheel covers, and style tone paint costs less than a Buick Special equipped with only an automatic transmission and radio? Why pay more and get less? Makes sense, doesn't it? And now, Fairlane versus Dodge Coronet. Last year, Dodge took one of the worst sales beatings in the history of the industry. This year, with an all-new car, Dodge is desperately trying to make a comeback. Let's see what they've done to it, and how it compares with the brilliant Fairlane. The lowest-priced Dodge Coronet V8 has a suggested list price which is over $100 more than the luxurious Fairlane with Special V8. Dodge should offer more car for that extra money. But do they? In performance, the Fairlane Special V8 has it all over the Dodge V8. The displacement of 272 cubic inches is greater than Dodge's 270. The compression ratio of 8.5 to 1 is higher than Dodge's 7.6 to 1. The Fairlane puts out 182 horsepower compared to 175 for Dodge and has a decided edge in torque, 268 pounds-feet to 240. It's an even greater story when you compare horsepower to weight. The Fairlane delivers 55.7 horsepower for every 1,000 pounds of car weight. Dodge has 51.5. Furthermore, Dodge's 14-millimeter old-style spark plugs, forged steel crankshaft, non-rotating valves, two-barrel carburetor, and single exhaust indicates that Dodge has not paid too much attention to performance and all-around engine durability. The Fairlane Special V8, of course, uses anti-fouling 18-millimeter spark plugs, precision-molded alloy iron crankshaft, free-turning valves, four-barrel carburetor, and dual exhaust. The much-advertised dashboard position of Dodge's PowerFlite transmission selector lever is farther away from the driver and obviously harder to reach. And just in passing, Dodge charges extra for a clock and cigar lighter, whereas they are standard equipment in the Fairlane. But to get back to transmissions and performance, Ford-O-Matic allows the driver to downshift up to 65 miles an hour for quicker passing. PowerFlite will downshift up to 55 miles an hour only. Furthermore, Ford-O-Matic gives the driver an accelerator control choice of low or intermediate gear starts, whereas PowerFlite always starts in low, regardless of traffic and road conditions. And when it comes to stopping power, the Fairlane's 192 square inches of brake lining is almost 10% greater than Dodge's 173.5, or for every 1,000 pounds of car weight, the Fairlane has 58.8 square inches of brake lining. Dodge has 51.1. A smaller brake for Dodge to stop a heavier car. And the Fairlane's brakes are fully self-energizing for easier stopping. Dodge's are only partially self-energizing. Again, in the front suspension, the Fairlane's modern ball joints are way ahead of Dodge's old-style kingpins, contributing to a smoother ride, greater stability, easier handling, longer life, and less maintenance. But let's compare interiors. At last, foam rubber is standard equipment on the Dodge front seat. The only competitive car we've looked at so far in the medium-priced field that adds this touch of luxury for the driver. But ask yourself this question. If foam rubber is so good, why is cheap cotton padding used on the rear seat of a Dodge Coronet? Why not foam rubber on both front and rear seats, as in the Fairlane? And if Dodge is really interested in true luxury and style, like their advertisements say, why did they put rubber floor mats in both front and rear instead of deep pile carpeting, as in the Fairlane? And why did they offer a choice of only three models, exclusive of station wagons, in the Coronet series, instead of six models, as in the Fairlane series, which includes not only a model comparable to every Dodge model, but also the most distinctive and luxurious, highly styled automobiles ever offered to the medium-priced car buyer? And in the Coronet line, why, if Dodge is really interested in true luxury, why did they offer a choice of only two interior trims, instead of a choice of 13 interior trims, as in the comparable Fairlane models? Maybe this so-called forward look Dodge is trying to promote is a little backward. Or perhaps it's because they don't have the volume production which permits Ford to offer more for less. But let's compare dimensions. Front headroom, Fairlane, 35.1 inches, Dodge, 35.5. Rear headroom, 34.2 to 34.9. Steering wheel clearance, equal at 5.4. Front seat height, 12.6 to 13.4. Rear seat height, 13.1 to 12.8. Front leg room, 44.3 to 44.5. Rear leg room, 41.9 to 45. Front shoulder room, 57 to 58. rear shoulder room 56.8 to 57.8. In one dimension, rear leg room, they beat Ford by this much, the length of a cigarette pack, just as they beat Pontiac, Oldsmobile, and Buick. The Fairlane is a wider car than Dodge, 75.9 inches to 74.5 inches. So far, we've uncovered no extra value features for which Dodge could ask an extra $100 over the Fairlane. So it must be here, in the preposterous 13 6/10 inches of greater outside length. Yes, Dodge beats General Motors at its own game of providing useless, hard-to-park bulk. Well, what have we seen in this film? We have seen that these four cars in the medium price field are fully competitive in interior roominess, competitive with each other and with the Fairlane. We have seen further that the Fairlane is a far more luxurious car in appointments, choice of models, choice of trims. It is an all-around better performer with modern engine, transmission, and brake features unsurpassed in the medium priced field. Not one of the four medium-priced competitors has yet advanced to modern ball-joint suspension. And above all, not one of its medium-priced competitors can offer so much car for so little. Ford's volume production makes this extra value possible. And there is your greatest advantage in selling the Fairlane against these competitors. Based on suggested list prices, comparable models of these four price leaders are still far more expensive than the glamorous Fairlane. The Pontiac 860 costs $70 more. Olds 88 costs $265 more. Buick Special costs $220 more. Dodge Coronet costs over $100 more. And for that kind of money, you can equip the already superior Fairlane with many of the new power assists and other accessories that today's fine car buyers want and demand. For that kind of money, you can ask any would-be medium-priced car buyer, why pay more and get less?